Hey, what's up guys? So we have a new update for Diablo 4 and there's so much good news and information over here. So anyways, let's go ahead and hop right into it. This is a post by David Kim titled System Design in Diablo 4 Part 1. And if you guys don't know who David Kim is, he's going to be a lead systems designer for Diablo 4. Now going into this article here, I'm here to kind of sum up and give you guys the important information that you guys actually want to read, but I will post the full thing down below if you guys are interested in checking that out. But to highlight what he mentioned in itemization, why this news is so good over here, he says, we're actively discussing ways to add more depth and complexity to base items, including rares. Ways to add greater variety to item affixes to make those powers interesting and your choices meaningful, and ways to give players more freedom to choose how to customize items so you can have fun exploring a wide range of effective gameplay possibilities instead of just looking up the optimal build online. So going further into this, and this is something that I did want to kind of explain here, because a lot of times you'll see on a lot of different Diablo forums, basically Diablo 2 was so much better, the itemization was so great in Diablo 2, and let me go and actually explain really quickly what this kind of means for us, because it does say specifically effective gameplay possibilities, meaning viable rares in the endgame. So let's go ahead and look at Mara's Kaleidoscope over here, which is a unique or legendary amulet here. This is from Diablo 2. You'll see that it says +2 to all skills, 5 to all attributes, and all resistances 30, which is great for any class in Diablo 2. This is an endgame viable amulet, but it might not be the best in slot for everyone, and let's go ahead and actually explain why. So looking at a rare amulet in Diablo 2, this one over here specifies +2 to assassin skills, which is great. This is obviously just going to be for assassins, so it's more niche, but it also offers that 3% mana stolen per hit. Now, that's really good because maybe you don't have to run a Vamp Gaze in your helm, or you don't have to have Mana Leech on something else. Having this makes it so you don't have to run Mana Potions, which is great. And then on top of that, it gives you a bunch of different resistances, and it technically gives you more cold resistance. So this can be the best in slot for maybe a very specific person over Mara's Kaleidoscope, which is arguably one of the best amulets in the game. But it goes further into that. This is a rare amulet. What about a blue, okay, a magic item? This item over here gives you +3 to combat skills. Sometimes in Diablo, specifically in Diablo 2, you're only going to spec into one build. This could be +3 to all lightning skills, so it could be more niche for a very specific role that your character wants to play, or maybe it's all fire, so you can have more items that would better suit you that no one would be able to have except for you, because obviously it rolls like randomly. For the most part, it's more so unique, not in like a legendary unique, but it's more unique as in not everyone's going to have that same item in slot, and so that makes you kind of feel a little bit more important over here. So that's a brief summary of that. But another thing I wanted to go over really quick that was posted in this is the elective mode system in Diablo 4, because this was actually something that was actually posted a few different times I saw it, but I did mention in one of my Diablo videos that elective mode will be a thing. So to explain what the heck people were complaining about, you'll see this screenshot over here on my right that says, highlighted under red, you see that there's defensive, there's fury, and then there's basic. Some people were worried that it was kind of like in Diablo 3, without the elective mode checked in, you'd basically be choosing one from each category. And this is not the case with Diablo 4. You will be able to select multiple from, let's say, one specific, I guess, section of it. I don't know why they actually have the system in place and all. I think it's more so for the casual players to kind of run like one of each thing, so they don't either run out of resource, or they have something to generate resource, if that makes sense. It's basically for newer players overall, but it is a mode that you'll just have to more than likely just tick in just like you would in Diablo 3. Alright, but anyways, going into more depth over here, this has to do with ancient items, which is really cool, and I wanted to highlight this over here. It says, ancients, as they don't really serve a clear purpose in Diablo 4, and they said they completely agree with the community sentiment, which is actually really good to hear, but they basically said they'll follow up with a update on this. And if you guys are new here and you want to see that follow-up, I do plan to cover it, everything Diablo 4 related, as well as PoE stuff, because I just love ARPGs, but I'm really curious to see what this follow-up means, because does that mean that they are going to be removing ancients and primal ancients? Some of you guys know kind of the system, how it works in Diablo 3. If your item is not ancient, especially in the weapon category, it's easily replaceable with another item that you might not even want. But sometimes the legendary ability can be so powerful that it outweighs that, which is something that they actually talk about, and I'll get into in a moment here. But basically, I think this is a huge deal. I would love to see this. However, I also want to offer the suggestion, because items are going to be tradable in the game, this might mean that just because you get an ancient item doesn't mean the item is completely useless to you now, because now you can just go ahead and potentially trade it off. So I think that there is some potential play with the whole items just being a lot better if they're ancient or primal ancient, but let me know, guys, how you feel about that whole system down below. I think that that is overall a great change. Now, going into the endgame progression, this is actually something that's pretty important too, and I'm so glad that they're mentioning this. But it says, as far as the endgame goes, we haven't decided whether the character leveling and experience system should be finite or infinite, meaning infinite would be like a Paragon system that we have in Diablo 3, where you just infinitely keep on scaling, and if you don't have the Paragon levels, you just can't either join certain Greater Rift pushing groups or whatever the case may be. A finite system is more like Diablo 2, where basically you have an endgame and you just can't progress after that. Like, the game doesn't scale infinitely with you just getting like EXP because you have a max level, and on top of that, technically the infinite progression is just trying to get those rare items that have insane rolls. Like, if you've played Diablo 2, you probably know about the Imp-Shank boots that were basically a duped item eventually, but for the most part, like, they were so incredibly difficult to find, or boots that were similar to that, or rare items that would be basically the best in slot. They would outclass certain items. But they don't really specify on this specific topic what they're going to do with it, but to give another example of what they probably plan to do over here, it says, for example, we're talking about thousands of hours of gameplay. Within those thousands of hours, you can choose to create a finite system that grants a million times more power than an infinite system, making it practically impossible for the infinite system to catch up in power. However, this offers a double-edged sword, because at that point, the infinite system is almost pointless. Why even have it in the first place? So let's use this for example. Let's say in Diablo 4, there's the Paragon system, but every time you get another Paragon point, it gives you 0.0000001 like percent of extra like damage. It basically renders it useless. Therefore, why even have it in the first place? I think their goal is to make it so the game is able to be played like infinitely, or it give the illusion at least of that, so people have kind of an incentive to play. But if the incentive isn't good, then why bother even adding it in the first place? Maybe if they just add it as some type of achievement, maybe that could be a good middle ground. But I'm curious to know how you guys feel about this system. I think as far as making it infinitely scaling like the Paragon system that we have in Diablo 3, I'm not too much of a fan of that, because it takes so long, and a lot of casual players generally don't reach like the GR like 100 plus. That's just naturally how it goes with a lot of different games. Even if you look at PoE endgame, most people don't even make it to endgame maps and complete the entire map and do Shaper and stuff like that. But I'm curious to know again how you guys feel about the infinite system versus a more finite system. AKA, do you guys want a max level and then that's it? And like, you know, you have your items that you can acquire and that's it? Or if maybe you do like a GR 150, there's like a primal ancient of an item. I don't know. But I do think it's cool that they are mentioning different systems to kind of incorporate it. But anyways, another thing that I wanted to highlight over here, because I mentioned it in one of my videos, but people wanted multiple ways to endgame, which in Diablo 3, as you guys know, it's pretty much just Greater Rifts, right? But ultimately, our goal is to create a meaningful system that provides clear choices depending on your preferred playstyle in the endgame. As of right now, as far as the endgame goes, I have covered this in a video, and I'll link it down below if you guys are interested in checking that out. As far as the endgame goes, it's pretty much like maps from Path of Exile, which I'll kind of dip into a little bit more here in a moment. But another thing that it was really important in this post is that legendary powers are just one part of an item's power, and they don't invalidate other affixes due to how powerful they are. Now, I have made a video going over all the legendary abilities in Diablo 4 as of right now, and again, I'll pin a lot of these videos down below because there's just so much information here. But to really sum it up, some of the legendary powers are absolutely insane. Like looking at this one over here, it makes your crit strike go up by 49% for 5 seconds. And that's like just way too powerful. But specifically in this post, it says that they won't invalidate other affixes due to how powerful they are. So maybe other affixes can be just as powerful, and at that point, why are they even legendary? I don't know, but this opens up the doors to a lot more possibilities, and overall, I'm happy for that. I want them to be a lot of different ways for us to make endgame viable, but again, I'll link all legendary abilities down below if you guys want to check out a video specifically on that. All right, so talking about endgame over here, key dungeons were basically the one that they showed off during the BlizzCon showcase, and anyways, it says over here in highlight, dungeon affixes being displayed on the key, players will be able to strategize their approach before going into the dungeon. So this is essentially maps from PoE. If you guys don't know what maps are from PoE, I'm going to briefly explain it. So the difference between, let's say, an endgame a grift is you go in, it's kind of random, right? But at the same time, there's going to be, you know, different enemies that spawn in, and sometimes depending on the enemies, you'll just close the rift if you're just searching to push one of those higher greater rifts. Whereas in Path of Exile's endgame, which is going to be similar to the key dungeons, you'll get this as a random drop that enemies will drop, and you'll pick it up and you'll be able to basically go into, let's say, the dungeon, or in PoE's case, a map. But over here, you'll see on the very bottom, the second to the last modifier over here, it says monsters deal 63% extra damage as fire. This can open up the doors for more potential here, and looking into even Diablo 3's itemization over here, we can see this unique legendary amulet that has a secondary ability where you get to prevent all fire damage taken and heal yourself for 10-15% of the damage prevented. So this kind of opens up the doors for more builds to be viable, specifically created for a set key dungeon, or if it rolls a certain modifier, just swap out your amulet, or just swap out one or two different pieces of gear, or you can go ahead and maybe snapshot to a completely different build like we have in Diablo 3. We have that wardrobe function where we'd be like, okay, we roll the map that has, you know, monsters deal this type of a damage, we can go ahead and swap our build instantly, or just swap one thing. This actually makes us so we'll actually keep more different items in our inventory or in our stash that can actually be useful, and we can swap them up versus just equipping what we have and just kind of utilizing it throughout its entirety. But I also want to provide this argument because it is kind of valid. A lot of times in Path of Exile, if you happen to have a map modifier that you can't do, you just either reroll it so you don't have that, or you just simply just don't do the map. You sell it, you trade it off, whatever the case may be, just so you don't happen to have that. But again, they've got a lot of work to do, and they're going to be explaining a little bit more here in the upcoming days or maybe week, because this is technically part one of the post. Part two isn't out yet, but when it does come out, guys, I will update you guys on that. So if you are new here and you want to keep up to date with everything Diablo 4, hit subscribe, turn on that bell, and you'll definitely see it as soon as it gets announced. But here's my thoughts on this, because I do kind of want to give you guys my thoughts on it. I think overall, every single thing that was mentioned is great. I mean, it's kind of vague on their system as far as like the end game, but they do give that hint to where they'll make it so the infinite system doesn't outclass the finite system in the game. And I do think that that's a huge deal, especially for more of a casual audience. And even people that are more hardcore to the game, like just grinding Paragon levels generally isn't seen as something that's super enjoyable. But let me know your thoughts on any of the things that we talked about down below. But thanks for tuning in, guys. And if you guys haven't checked out, like I said, all the legendaries in Diablo 4 to really give you guys a better feel, check the pinned comment and check out those videos. But thanks for tuning in, guys. Hopefully you enjoyed the video. And if you did, drop a like on it. And if you're new here, subscribe. And I'll definitely catch you guys in the next one. Thanks for tuning in. I'm signing out. Peace.